Call today's meeting to order. First thing is the approval of the agenda, and notice there is an addition to the agenda.
Move to approve with the addition.
Okay, we got a motion by Grant, second by Kevin to approve the agenda with the addition. Any further discussion? Not all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, okay. Just as a note that Jim will not be attending today's meeting. Citizens to be heard, did we get any requests to be from citizens?
No, Mr. Chair, we did not.
Okay. The approval of the payment of bills and vouchers?
Move approval.
Second.
Got a motion by Kevin, second by Grant to approve the bills. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, motion passes. Next thing is the approval of the minutes for June 2nd. As you can see, that there was May 26th written in there, but it's been amended to June the 2nd. So we got the minutes of June 2nd to approve.
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay, we got a motion by Grant, second by Jenny to approve the minutes. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And with that, we're going to go into request for abatement of property tax penalty for Lilac Homes. Dilworth, we've got Bill Nelson here. You want to have a seat there up in those chairs there? Okay, your request is to have your property reduced or?
The penalty.
The penalty.
Well, yeah, if you want to go with that reduction, we can.
Okay. All right, very good. And I guess you've given some reasons for it in your presentation. You want to go over some of that for the?
Sure. My name is Bill Nelson. I'm a co-owner of Lilac Homes. Just a brief summary. We have two facilities in Moorhead and one in Dilworth. The property taxes in Moorhead were paid on time. The property taxes in the Dilworth location is the reason for the request. Around the 16th of April, I think we got COVID in right around the 16th. We had, I think it was 9 total losses in our Moorhead buildings. About a 35% revenue reduction in Moorhead. And trying to properly budget, I didn't want to put myself in a position where I was faced with the challenge of meeting payroll or paying my property taxes for Dilworth. So the request that I had was, if possible, my request is to avoid the penalty from the first half property taxes in Dilworth. Since this initial request, I was able to submit and fund an EIDL loan, which then gives me the ability to pay that property tax. On the 15th, when the taxes were due, I had submitted that previously but didn't hear back from any of those grants or anything like that. So I was concerned about cash flow going over the next 90 days. It didn't look very good, losing 35% of our revenue. So I opted to not pay that tax. And since my EIDL loan has come through, I'm prepared to pay the tax. And my request, I guess, is to see if you'd be willing to bypass the penalty.
Okay. Okay, the penalty shows $19.56 for the penalty, right? Okay, have you paid your taxes since then, or nothing's been paid yet? So the penalty is even higher by now, huh? Okay. Any questions for Mr. Nelson?
Well, I don't think it's a question for me. Basically, I just want you to know that our hearts go out to the losses that you experienced and that the difficulties that you and your staff endured in terms of taking care of those people. And so my apologies to you that was the situation that you were presented in. But I appreciate the things that you laid out for us in terms of how you went about keeping staff on in terms of in this crisis. And so, I definitely would support waiving the penalty portion of your taxes. And I think based on how we usually evaluate waiving those penalties, I definitely think that it fits within the parameters of doing such.
that a motion?
Well, I didn't know if you had anything. I'll make a motion. I don't know if it's more than that, but I will just make a motion to waive the penalties as requested.
I'll second that.
Okay.
If I could just have a clarification and question. So the so you have the funds now to pay the tax itself, mm-hmm. and the I think there might be a slight bit of interest in there. I don't think we've ever waived interest, but I think typically, normally, when we do this just to protect ourselves, we usually put a if paid by date in there. So I think it would be
sure.
good for us to follow precedence there.
Okay.
You know, so Commissioner Mojo.
I guess my motion would include waiving the penalty and any interest accrued as long as the payment is made by the end of this week.
Yep. Okay, we've got a motion by Jenny and a second by Grant to waive the penalty and the interest until the end of this week if the taxes are paid. Is there any further discussion?
I just want to also agree with Jenny that that had to be a really difficult time for your business, and to go through that was so.
And I guess our policy does say, you know, in the event of disasters, flood, fire, tornado, I think this COVID-19 sort of qualifies in some situation there. So call for the vote. Unless there's further discussion, call for the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. If you can get them paid by this Friday, we appreciate that.
Great. Thank you much. Thanks for your leniency.
Okay, we have one. What's the addendum? Let's look at the addendum. There's a request for Highland Hideaway to renew liquor license.
Yes, Mr. Chair, that is the request before you this morning, or this afternoon.
Is there any, there's no problem with this or anything?
There's no problem. It was that it just got to the auditor's office, and they were just able to get everything done this afternoon, so.
Okay.
Make a motion to approve the request.
Second.
Okay, we've got a request to approve the liquor wine license for Highland Hideaway in Holly. Any further discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, and then Colleen, I don't know if I got that. Who, it was Jenny?
I made the motion.
Jenny made the motion, and Kevin seconded that. Okay. Now we'll go into Kathy with our COVID-19 update. I think we've already got our handouts.
Yes, good evening, Mr. Chair and Commissioners. The first page that I handed to you was, it'll show kind of the trend and history of our cases. So we're going back to March 16th, where we had our first positive case, and now through June 15th yesterday. So you can see, you know, the number of cases and how they've increased in Clay County. And then the second column is those that are released from isolation or no longer needing isolation, no more cases. So as we go down, that of course would increase with the number of cases that we have tested. So you see the difference between the 506 and 455. We also have the deaths in there, and although every death is significant, we don't want to minimize deaths, and it's tough on family and others to have any death from COVID. We have a total of 36 as of yesterday in our county. So we've increased with those that had COVID and then succumbed to that virus. So it's 36, although the number is lower than in many other areas. It's, you know, we still recognize that's a significant, that's significant for friends and
nice
family.
It's nice to see that's holding steady. You see the state of Minnesota is going down quite a bit too.
Right, yes. And then you see the active cases now as of yesterday, that's 15. So there's only 15 cases right now currently in Clay County. that we're needing to do case investigation, and then contact tracing would include a number larger than that. That's 15 cases, but depending on how many contacts they have, we would follow up. But that's a pretty good number.
Yes, very
pretty
good.
Low number. So we've seen a bit of a decrease this week, so we'll look at the trends and watch to see how that's going. We hope it doesn't increase. We're still doing the point prevalence testing in the congregate care, long-term care, assisted livings. Minnesota Department of Health is working with the Minnesota National Guard in many of those cases and doing point prevalence testing. So just that day testing, testing those residents and staff, and they'll do that with three series. So, and they are between 7 and 14 days apart for those testing. We also have the static testing sites in Fargo, and those are set up. They're the National Guard that's setting up those sites. I think I mentioned that last week. And we are able to assist those congregate care settings to get their staff tested over there. They make appointments, they take all of the staff from Clay County as well as the Fargo side, and they can be tested at those static sites per appointment. So that's working out quite well to get testing done right away. And then of course you saw in Fargo where they had the mass testing, they set that up last Thursday and Friday. I believe it's going to be set up again this week. And that is just for anyone in Minnesota and North Dakota. So people can go through that mass testing. There was 878 that were tested on Thursday and 903 on Friday. And so I think that went pretty well. There was no requirement. The testing at Sanford and Essentia, they need to meet some requirements as far as having symptoms or being exposed to someone that was positive. But this mass testing, it was anyone could go through. So
is that a free testing then, or do you have free to turn that into insurance?
Nope, that's free. I mean, someone's paying for it, but the customer doesn't have to. So yeah.
Okay.
So right, that doesn't go through insurance. They don't do the insurance process with those testing. And I believe the static testing doesn't go through the insurance either for those staff right. That can go over to this those sites per appointment. The second page, I just wanted to show you that it lists a number of the states across the United States. You can see these are daily cases. And where Minnesota, you know, we're trending down a little bit in daily cases versus 2 weeks ago. North Dakota's trending up just a tad, but it's not like a huge influx of numbers, but they're in the orange, as you can see. Minnesota's in the green, so we're trending down a bit. And then it shows the other states across the United States that are either trending up or down or staying about the same. The third page I have is new and total cases, average new cases per day. So it shows United States 3 weeks ago, 22,587. And then you can see 2 weeks ago it was 21,000. Last week it was 20,700. So you can see kind of the trends of average new cases per day. And then I thought it would be interesting to show Minnesota and North Dakota as well. So you can see Minnesota 3 weeks ago was 701. This is new cases per day again. And then they trended down a bit in Minnesota each of those weeks. North Dakota was up 3 weeks ago, went down 2 weeks ago, but then kind of is coming back up and going back down. So they're fluctuating a little bit.
Okay, just I'll go back to that page two again. Like Alaska and Hawaii and Vermont, is that showing that their cases are going up?
Trending up.
Mm-hmm. They're trending up, huh?
And some of it may be, there might be some part of that that's increased testing, but some of them also just as, they're watching the states that are really opening up and just to see if we're seeing more cases after people are, you know, less social distancing, maybe less use of the face mask. So we're, you know, that'll be interesting to watch. As the cases, will they rise in some of those communities that are really opening up widespread? Seems to be a little bit true for Arizona. They opened up in May. They're seeing a trend up. They're not contributing that totally to testing. So they're thinking there may be some, again, more spread, community spread, lack of social distancing, maybe a little bit less adherence to wearing the cloth face mask. So I understand where people get a little tired of this and the social, you know, being isolated. So it's easy to just want to go out and not have to worry about all that. But we have to watch that just because, you know, COVID hasn't gone away. We're going to be seeing it, you know, potentially, as the experts say, ramp up in the fall. So we really need to be watching what the trends are doing.
I see they're coming up with some good ideas with these masks already, the turtleneck type thing or whatever it's called, or hoodie or whatever. Some nice masks out there already.
Did you get one yet?
No, I haven't. No, my wife made me one and I can barely breathe through it, so I think there's an ulterior motive there.
Maybe she planned that.
Yeah, I think there's a very tight straps too, so.
Do you want to maybe get one from us?
Probably. I'm looking for a new brand, yes.
No more comments on that.
Okay.
And then on the third and fourth page, it's really just showing our new cases still growing. So another little graph to show, you know, New York is kind of has been always a problem. So the first page is showing New York in comparison to Minnesota as far as trending up. These are cases per 100,000 people. And then on the last page, we're showing North Dakota as well. So New York in comparison to North Dakota. So, you know, I think generally speaking, you know, we're doing pretty well. I wish we had no deaths from COVID, but for the most part, we're doing better than many across the United States. So any questions? I know I went through that quick because I know I have a deadline.
In terms of watching numbers, how confident are you that we are prepared to deal with if there is a second wave in Clay County? Do we have the supplies and the manpower that we need to?
You know, they will need to. They are working on getting. We have enough personal protective equipment right now that we can receive, and they will actually start replenishing those stocks. What I heard from someone at one of the healthcare facilities, Sanford or Essentia, they had nurses that were using one mask and one for every week. So they weren't even getting new masks. They are now finally, just last week, getting some extra masks so they don't have to keep reusing masks. So that's good news that there's more PPE, personal protective equipment, cash. So they are certainly, MDH is working on, you know, we're looking at how is this going to look. We're working with some of the colleges right now to look at how is that going to look when the students come back. And so MDH has some resources out there for the campuses, and I have a staff person working with those, the leadership of those colleges. So there's a lot of work to continue doing for a potential in the fall, and we're pretty confident there will be no vaccine. They keep saying they're trying to expedite it, but we're pretty confident we won't see that this fall based on some of the experts. We will have the flu vaccine, of course, but we're going to have the flu, of course, ramp in the fall too. So we'll have the influenza and we'll have COVID. So it's going to be an interesting mix there. Did I answer your question, Commissioner Mojo?
Okay.
Any other questions for me?
Any questions or further questions? No, thank you for the update.
Okay, you're welcome. Thank you.
Okay, with that, we'll go into the public hearing for our five-year plan for the road construction.
I'll make a motion to open the public hearing.
Okay, we got a motion to open the public hearing.
Second.
Motion by Cheney, second by Grant. To open the public hearing for five-year road construction. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. So, have we got any calls from cities that are participating, or?
I don't believe so. I checked with Emma, she's downstairs, and they were supposed to have called prior to 5:30, and we didn't. There's nobody on the line, and nobody had called in so far, so.
And are the doors open if anyone wants to come in?
Yes.
Okay.
So you're going to cover that five-year plan for us? And
yeah, Justin was going to bring the map up if we had anything to talk about. We'd have the map on the wall here. We went through the five-year plan, I think, a couple different times at the Highway Committee. And we wanted to, pretty much everything from 2020 is in place and under contract. There's Project number 10 is on County Road 1. That one is still in the right-of-way acquisition process. So we got a few more signatures last week again. There's been several discussions with regard to our appraisal. So we've been, Justin has been reaching out to Tingem Appraisal Services, looking into some things there. It's actually going pretty decent. It's right-of-way is slow. It just takes a long time. And I thought this one would be a little quicker than the average, but it's not. So we're forging ahead. We're still meeting daily with the locals out there.
Okay. Were we discussing about moving that to next year?
If we don't get our right-of-way acquired here shortly, we'll run out of construction season because we still got the advertisement to take. It takes 30 days, and contracts take a few weeks. And so it's roughly 6 weeks to 8 weeks before you even start turning dirt. So it seemed like things aren't going very good for this year, but we wanted to keep forging ahead just to see if we could get it on, stay on
track. Okay, for those watching, that is Highway 1 in Oakport Township for 2 miles, so.
Correct,
that's
yep.
The one we're working on, where we're slow in getting the right-of-way, so.
Right. We do still have a little bit of a utility potential conflict out there that's not completely resolved yet, and that's with CenturyLink, so there's another outstanding issue there that if we don't get construction underway this year, at least we could get that utility out of the right-of-way or move to the edge of our new right-of-way. Like I said, year 2020 is mostly under contract. The first six projects are federal aid bridge replacements called the BROS program, bridge off-system bridges. So we've got several hundred thousand dollars of federal aid bridge dollars there. Basically what that's doing is it's relieving a lot of pressure off the bridge bond funding program, which seems to be kind of a negotiated point every year with the legislature. They kind of play around with, it seems like, with the bonding, and our bridge bonding's tied in there, and some years we get dollars and some years we don't. When I first started, it was a consistent $40 million every other year, but now it's not quite that safe. So we've also got project number 7 is County Road 8. That's kind of a new process to us. We're doing a full depth reclamation with stabilized base on that one. Got pretty good bids on it, got a good contractor on it. Justin has already held the pre-construction conference, and I believe the work is gonna start in July on that one.
No, they're starting on Monday.
Oh, they're starting on Monday. So remember there was a little issue with trying to get it done before the pre-haul campaign on the sugar beet. So looks like that's gonna be.
So their preliminary schedule, it looks like it should be done first week of August. And as of now, they are looking at the schedule as they are starting next week, so.
Okay, for those looking at that, that's in Kurtz Township, and that's about 4.5 miles of road there.
Yep. Right. We've got our County Road 14, that's project number 8. County Road 14 from Highway 336 to 17, that's mill and overlay. That one is under contract as well. County Road 33, that's been another project that we've had several discussions with over the past years with the locals up in Highland Grove and Cromwell area. That's 6.5 miles mill and overlay. That one will start
second week of July.
That's the yeah. Same contractor.
Week after the fourth.
Okay, now that's, they're gonna need that to be done too by beat the harvest, isn't it?
That one will go quick. It's just a mill and overlay. So as soon as they mill it off, they'll be paving right behind it. So.
Okay.
Easily be done by August.
That would yeah. Kind of estimated 4 to 5 days of paving and 2 days of milling, so.
Very good.
Skipping to project number 11, I think is it 11, 12? are those two under the same contract? We've let several box culverts together. The first six were together.
11 and 12 is also grouped together with the Morgan Township.
That's
box
right.
Culvert. Yep. And they're starting on the Morgan Township structure next week. The week after that will be the box culvert on 12, and the week after that will be the box culvert on 2.
You say a box culvert in Morgan Township. We don't have.
Yep.
Do we have one listed from Morgan?
That's on the township system, so we don't show them on our five-year construction plan.
Very
but
good.
It's just not under the same contract.
Very good. Thank right. you.
And then the last two on 7, or County Road 7, that one's the one with the watershed. That's combined with the two watershed projects on Kurtz Township. roadways as well, so those three are packaged together. And then project number 14 would be lumped with project number 10, and that one's still kind of waiting for right away. Any questions on year 2020? Year 2021, the first four projects, 15 through 18, are bridge replacements. Those are mostly bridge bond funds with a small amount of county state aid funds. We do have project number 16 is an actual bridge. It's not a box culvert. That's a little over $600,000, so there's a little bigger share of county participation on that one, which basically covers the grading cost, because there's, in order to keep the curves some sort of a reasonable design speed. Right now it's real tight and narrow. We had to adjust the alignment a little bit to fit that in there, so there's additional costs that are outside of the bond funding. Project number 19 is a overlay on County Road 6. We've been generating a lot more calls and concerns on that project, so I'm sure people will be happy to see that one. Project number 20 is the landfill road, mill and overlay. It's an awful rough road. It gets a lot of traffic and surprisingly almost very little, if any, calls. So very patient customers out there, but I really would like to see this one done. We've applied several times for local road improvement grants on it and we're unsuccessful, but we felt we needed to get it on our plan and get it built up. Project number 21 is on County Road 2, east of Comstock. That was the project that slid back 1 year. It was currently slated for 2020, but we moved it back 1 year. Project 22 is on County Road 1. That one more than likely will slide down to 2022, depending on the right of way for this year. And the last project on the page is a cooperative project in the city of Holly on County Road 33. It's about a $1.3 million project, a large portion of that project, and we've already got this kind of agreed on an MOU with the city of Holly, but their share is about 2/3 and our share is about 1/3. They've got infrastructure underneath there that they need to be replaced, and I know they've been anxiously awaiting this project as well, so we'll probably start designing and working with them on that later this fall. I'm assuming more engineering, their city engineering firm, will do most of the work on it, real similar to how our Glendon project went. One thing to note too, I'll bring it up because I know we've all heard it, but with the pandemic that we're in, they're looking at reduction in state aid funds, maybe as much as 15%. And we have conservatively always had about $3.2 million shown for the remainder of the plan, not counting the first year, because we know what our allotment is that year, so we put the actual dollars like in 2020. That $3.2 million would be actually even underneath a 15% reduction, so it's been good that we've kept that and held that number constant. So
as compared to 3.7.
Right, and even 3.9 this year.
Or 3.9, yeah.
Yep. So I feel like we're sitting pretty good. If we do see a reduction, we shouldn't have to start reducing projects on our plan.
Well, I think that's an interesting perspective that I think we should talk about too is, I know when we bonded for some projects, that was saved the county a lot of money in terms of advancing some projects. And I think if we're looking at a possible reduction now, and maybe we've talked about this at Highway, but now may be a good time to revisit bonding for some of these projects again.
Yeah, I think it was 2 months ago or 3 months ago we brought that up, and I think the Highway Committee directed us to put together a little bit of a plan and bring it back.
Okay, good.
Yep. Year 2022, the first two projects are bridge replacements again. Those are split 50-50. Those are on county state aid system. So the program there is it's 50-50 with your state aid dollars versus bridge bond dollars. Project number 26 is on County Road 12, and I think it is the most highest traveled road in Clay County. So we're looking at doing an overlay on that, as well as we've got project 27 is on Highway 52. I'm hoping those kind of get let together or let at the same time. We got federal aid dollars on that one, and that was one of the first projects I worked on back in 2001 from I-94 back down to Sabin. We are planning to kind of incorporate the city limits of Sabin in there. It's awful rough there. When we did it 20 years ago, it wasn't in too bad a shape, and we didn't do the work in there, but it definitely needs a little bit of mill and overlay through town as well.
Just got a question on, not so much on the program, you say County 12 is a high, mostly highly direct. Is that leading to somewhere? I mean, I know where it's at, but what's the, do you know what the common reason
maybe
for?
Maybe the growth in South Fargo, I guess. It's always been, I think, well, I think Wall Street maybe was our highest traffic, our highest traveled roadway, but I think with the toll bridge coming off, it pulled a lot of traffic actually off of Wall Street. There was a tremendous amount of vehicles that went further north there just to get around there, which is good. I guess it pulled some of the traffic. You know, Wall Street's kind of a neighborhood there. You don't really want to have your main arterial running through there, but I think just with the development down south, even in South Moorhead, there's been a lot more cars there, mm-hmm. a lot more commuter traffic, people, you know, it's a good route to the interstate as well. It's a fairly decent route for the folks in the south going to the east of the lake, so I guess I'm not exactly sure why traffic's so high there other than it must be the development down that area.
So what does that connect up to in North Dakota?
52nd.
Yep. Okay, that's where 12th, okay.
Yep. And project number 28, we also have federal aid dollars on that one. That's County Road 31, south of Holly. It's getting very rough, and it's definitely ready for an improvement on that. And then project number 29, that's our County Road 3, or just past the courthouse here on 11th Street. We're looking at an overlay from County Road 18 by the sugar beet plant up to Wall Street.
That 31, that mill and overlay is the same thing as we're doing on 33 north of Hall.
Right, real similar.
Okay. Yep.
Dave, is there going to be a road raise on 3 with Moorhead's project?
I believe that'll probably be done either this year and or next year. Is that right? Where they're doing the dike there.
Yep.
They bought out all those homes with the exception of one or two, and
right.
There will be a small portion of that on our shoulder, on the kind of the west shoulder.
Yep.
I believe.
There, a planned road raise for three itself.
It kind of ties into our road, doesn't
yeah.
it? I think what it does is it kind of ties into County Road 3, and
okay.
then it travels to the north and loops around kind of in the vicinity of where those homes are moved out. I think there's very little work done on a road. There's a little bit, but it's not like a big road raise on a road.
Okay.
I know Justin's worked with, is it Brady?
Brady Wall.
Yeah.
Southeastern Engineering.
Yeah. Okay. They've kept us in the loop. They've
and
sent us plans.
Just to get some more information on that 31 and 33, why is there federal aid funding on 31, but not on 33? Less
well,
state aid funding.
So when we go to those STIP meetings, I guess we request the dollars, and that's there was a certain threshold on what I thought we could apply for, and I requested those federal aid on 30. You know, there's only so many dollars, so it could have requested them on any one of these projects on here, but I just requested it on 52 and 31.
Okay.
So it's the process is they have target values for how much dollars each county gets federally, and there's a priority ranking, and when our priority came up, I put in for these two projects for it. So it could have been on 12, it could have been on.
And there's a time sequence too, isn't there, involved mm-hmm. with that, with the STIP?
Yeah.
Like if Clay County doesn't get something every year.
No.
Absolutely not.
Right.
Yeah, with these dollars, well, we haven't seen a nickel of federal aid for roads since we did the road on 52.
Hmm.
They had some shortages where they were looking to put dollars away, and we ended up getting over $3 million for that concrete overlay from Sabin mm-hmm. to Baker.
Mm-hmm.
And what that did was and I think it's good to get all your money at one time rather than have a little here and a little there, because federal aid projects take a lot more to administer. So we got a large chunk of money at one time, and we haven't seen any dollars now for almost 12 years.
Can I have a follow-up to that, Mr. Chair? So the MPO, which would be the metropolitan area, that they get allocated a different set of dollars through STIP than what Clay County gets, right?
Yep.
But the MPO can, like the MPO for us, they could support Clay County's requests.
And they do. I think there's a application process that goes through the MetroCog as well as the MnDOT's.
Right.
Through the ATP.
because the MPO always has somebody on the STIP board, but Clay County doesn't always have somebody on the STIP board. So we always are aware of what the MPO is doing for our area, right?
Correct.
Well, you sit on the Transportation Technical Committee, and so that's all the regional engineers with MetroCog.
And I think I'm the current county engineer representative for the ATP right now as well. All right.
I was just looking at the advocacy for what we need and how the process works.
2023, projects number 30 and 31 are bridge replacements. One of them's on the county state aid highway on Highway 19, so that one's split 50-50 with state bridge bonding. And project number 31 is on County Road 69. One thing to note too, that the state bridge bonding dollars are, we're hoping that we have those when we get them. So I think at the bottom, we always kind of state it's according to availability. And if the bridge bond dollars aren't there, then those projects get designed to put on the shelf and kind of held until we have funds. Project number 32 is a mill and overlay on County Road 34. So from the city of Ulin out to the Becker County line. It definitely needs, there's not a lot of traffic out there, but there's over 800, and it'll be nice to get out there and get that one patched up. We've got two projects on County Road 18.
Excuse me, just on the 34.
Yep.
You're just going to start on the east limits of the city? Ulin, you're not going to go through town on that one, huh?
It's not determined completely where we're going to start and stop. I think that's at a minimum we'll start there. I know I've also got, I've been working with that lobbyist, with Barb Rohde and Associates, and what I'd really like to do, and I'm trying to put together some sort of a small city package, you know, if there is any earmarks, but in doing so, it's kind of got me to think a little bit about, you know, we've got work we could do in Ulin, we got work we should do in Felton. We have a small county road in Dilworth on the south side of Trunk Highway 10 there. And I'd like to potentially maybe put together kind of a package to do some of this city work, since it's not quite the same as just rural paving. But to answer your question, I don't think we're completely held to the east city limits of Ulin. Since we're out there, we very well might go through town and start.
Yeah, because I think the city of Ulin was concerned about the condition of 34.
Yeah, being that it's out in 2023, that'll give us some time.
Could you include in that group of things that you're looking at, the local funding that would be needed for project number 35?
Yep, correct. And that would be the main driver of that, would be that project, and then we could tie in some smaller cities as well. But yep, that would definitely be the main hub on a project like that. Mm-hmm. So we'll definitely take an account, Frank, that work in City Ulin as well. There was a couple years ago that the city did a little project through town there in Ulin, and they did some small strip paving. And at the time, I wish I would have said, well, maybe we should do it right from curb line to curb line, even if the county had to pay a small share. But that would have been the time to do it. I kind of feel like I missed an opportunity there to cost share with them.
No, I think they got curb and gutter along there, and right. A lot of that stuff is breaking off right by the right by the curb. And,
well, and it's been overlaid several times, so it's real high at the curb level. So it's going to take a little bit more design work, but I'm committed to doing something there too. Since we're that far out, it'd be the time to do it.
Well, depending on what our small cities meeting looks like in either late September or October, I think that we should bring this to collaborate and maybe coordinate if they see anything on the horizon that we can really tag team the project.
Sure. Projects number 33 and 34 are fairly new to our plan. When we went ahead with the full depth reclamation project on County Road 8, we've got another section of our roadway that would be ideal for something like this, and it's project 33. It's County Road 18, and it's from County Road 19 that goes through Glendon and then back to the west to the Buffalo River. It's got gravel shoulders. It's a real old section that I don't know how it's been hanging in there, but it's not terrible, but I think it's been since the 60s since we did anything. It's so bad it's crumbling on the very edges where the white lines are, so it's a lot of our painted edge lines are actually breaking off. But we'd like to do another full depth reclamation, barring, you know, maybe some unforeseen things that we don't like. But there's a lot of counties that are doing this. It's kind of a recycling type of a method. So we're pretty excited about doing that. It's 1.7 miles, and then we would also do a 3.2 mile overlay going east back over to Trunk Highway 9. There's over 1,000 cars a day on those sections of roadway, so I think it's an improvement that definitely needs to be on the radar. So we put that one on there. Project 35, like Commissioner Campbell mentioned, that's an urban reconstruct in the city of Comstock. We've been trying to kind of tie that in with any FM diversion work that, you know, but I don't, at this point, that is outside of the project. So we are committed to doing work there. I've met with the mayor several times. We talked about drainage. I know the roadway is quite low. There's not a lot of curb and gutter there. At this point, we've got a little shortage in our funds. So we're trying to figure out how we can piece this one together. If we do not see any additional funds, it may have to continue to be pushed down and planned for and try to figure out a way. Like I said, right now I'm working on some sort of a cooperative small city application or request, I guess, through the federal highway department through like earmarks or.
Well, if I can comment on, you know, prior to plan B on the diversion project, there clearly would have been some impacts to the Comstock area, and I think back then we'd footnoted it, and I think we would have insisted on something being done there. But now with the right now the project shows no impacts to Comstock, so that kind of changes the funding mechanism of where the money's going to come from. That's why I suggested we try to see if we can incorporate that into that.
Right. And, you know, Justin and I will continue to do what we can to look for additional grant funds. Maybe there's a program that will come through MnDOT, maybe a local road improvement application or something. But we're going to do everything we can to try to find those dollars and to keep this one on schedule. Mm-hmm. The last project on 2023 is a fairly sizable mill and overlay on County Road 26. Last year we had a real extensively long portion of this project. We thought it might be better just to do the worst 7.5 miles, so it would be the piece from County Road 27 to County Road 19. So there's a lot of aggregate being hauled out there. There's a lot of ruts out there. We get a lot of phone calls when it rains as far as being a little dangerous. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to overlay the worst section as well as spread the dollars out, and that's kind of where we picked up the dollars for County Road 18. And then in the following year, in 2024, we pick up an additional, I think it's 9.5 miles underneath project number 39. So then that would basically get it from Trunk Highway 75 all the way to Highway 19. So we knock off another 9.5 miles. And I think what we're gonna do is continue to keep picking away at that section. Right. You can see it on there from Highway 75 to the Red River on County Road 26. We still got one piece there. We did some maintenance overlays on that not too long ago. It's kind of funny. All the heavy traffic is mostly going from east to west. So we put an overlay on the westbound section, and now the eastbound section is starting to rut, and the westbound section looks pretty good, where 7-8 years ago it was completely the opposite. So it's kind of hanging in there, but we'll get to that last section too. The last page of our plan on year 2024, project number 37, we've got mill and overlay on County Road 11. Norman County did some work a few years back. They overlaid their section. We didn't have any dollars at the time to join them, but I'd like to finish that last section. There's the Felton Pilers right there on the corner of 34 and 11. There's a fair amount of traffic, you know, in the fall that gets to that piler, as well as, there's over 400 cars a day on there. It's not a terribly heavy section, but there's some cracks up there that need to be repaired. And, I guess that's another kind of a new project that we added onto our list there. Project number 38 is on County Road 14. That's a bridge replacement that we've got federal aid, the same dollars that we have for 2020, those BROWS dollars. We got just over $700,000 there to help replace that bridge. That'll be real nice to get that out of there. Believe it or not, that thing's kind of hanging in there. It's not posted down or anything. It's just, it's narrow, geometrics aren't real good. It's always going to have issues with the flooding as it's a big overflow section there. And there's really not a lot you can do with that unless you build that bridge quarter mile long, which you would never do. But kind of looking forward to finally getting rid of this one. We've been working on, I think we started designing on this thing probably 5 years ago or more.
Well, it's going to be another 5 years till we get to it, too.
Right. Project 39, like I said, that's the last, you know, another section of County Road 26 from County Road 19 to Highway 75. Project number 40 is a mill and overlay from the tieback levee by the CW store there in Comstock to the Red River. So we're looking at mill and overlay of that section there. And then project number 41 shows our dollars for the commitment to the grade separation project on 11th Street. So we did add a few new projects this year, which I'm pretty excited about. I think we're pretty well, we're pretty spread out throughout the county. I know over the years, there's been remarks made that we do all our work in one section of the county or another. And I guess I feel like we're really knocking off a lot of roads that need work on there. We're spread out in different parts of the county. I feel pretty good about our plan. In fact, I feel like this is one of the best plans that we've ever really put together as far as really doing a lot of good work in a lot of different places.
Can I comment quick on 41, or 40, excuse me, you talked about the Red River west to the tieback, you know, the tieback levy piece. Wouldn't there be local funding in that because of the diversion, because of how that's affected?
So the way they got it right now is I believe that tieback levy's 2025. Mm-hmm. So what we're planning for is that where we would start our overlay, that they would build the levee and then continue that over to Highway 75. So the diversion would fund that last section there, and our section would start where their limits are. Mm-hmm. So our plan is to build everything to the west, to the Red River, and then there'd be like, is that, do you want to zoom in on that? I don't know if it shows that, how big the map is, but there's about 750 feet or so between, is that, I guess it doesn't really show it.
No, it's hard to show.
There's a little, there's about a 700-foot section there where the tieback levee is and right to the intersection that I guess their dollars are, that we're planning on them taking care of in there.
Right, but that road will be affected.
Yeah, maybe.
Their project, right?
I guess I'm not really following you.
But if you're saying that the urban reconstruction in Comstock wouldn't qualify for local dollars because it's not affected, if anything, and this whole plan is affected by diversion, that Project 40 would be. So I think that diversion funds should help with that project.
Right. We'll talk about that a little more. I see what you're saying.
Well, so the diversion project is planning on paying for the reconstruction in the area.
From the west limits to Trunk Highway 75.
Right, and that's the area that the project is impacting.
Correct.
The area that you're referring to would not be impacted by that project.
Increased traffic would be about the only thing. But as far as the road profile will not change in the area that we're doing.
Right.
So there's no area of that road that will see water because of the tieback? I guess
I think that road is meant to stay open.
Correct.
Right? Under the design, isn't that
I think it is. I think the pool gets definitely fairly shallow the further south you go.
Right. I think the intent there is that road would remain open, and, you know, and that's why they're doing an up and over the tieback levee so that it can. We can certainly.
The part of my question is I think that there's going to have to be some sort of road raise in order to keep that open.
Right.
And so that would incur additional costs. because of that, and then,
right,
and it would be affected by diversion.
If there's a need for a road raise, then certainly we should be advocating for.
I think the worst spot, though, is as you get to the bridge, is where it jumps down, and that bridge closes, like this spring, that bridge was closed.
Mm-hmm.
So in order for the whole works to be open, you'd have to build the bridge and build everything up.
Well, I think it brings a point that there's a lot more discussion that we should probably,
right,
have with the Diversion 30 in terms of what would happen to that road.
Okay, I know we're talking 5-year plan for the county. Do we have any plan, or is there a plan that what the townships are going to do? Do they have to submit anything? I mean, I realize they can do their own roads.
Right.
But do they ever submit a plan that we know what's going to happen as far as the township roads?
We try to work with them on their annual graveling, which is really about the extent of what they do. So even trying to kind of work with them on that and getting gravel maps from them, so we've got it's about as much information as we ever get from them. I think you're right, Frank. We are by law required to do a 5-year plan to show that we are spending these dollars and planning for them. Their town road dollars do come from taxes, but I don't believe that they're required to do the same thing.
Mr. Chairman, I think the townships, the way they fund their projects and their roads, they do it through their annual road and bridge levy, and based on what they're doing in that given year, they have to assess a certain dollar amount for their individual township in order to qualify for the state reimbursement for, and I think that's the only thing that I know of that.
The reason I'm asking that, because I'm still referring to that 15th Street and hallway.
Right.
You know, I see it's closed. I don't know if it's open. I haven't been there this week. I don't know if it's open now or not. But I mean, does the townships or the city have any plans of doing that road, because
right,
I know there's county people concerned about driving that road, so what is our answer to that? Well, that's up to the townships. Well, that's
right.
I mean, do we know what the townships are doing on the roads?
I know Cromwell did put chloride on that section and gravel it. So that from the city limits going north is actually the best part of the whole road.
Yeah, right, but
it's a south
piece. Close now, or it was.
Right. I think the city's Odyssey piece is what's falling apart on them, and they're trying to keep all the heavy stuff out of there this spring, so that they've been barricading it up, and people have been going around the barricades, and I stopped out there about 2 weeks ago and seen the city staff trying to close it to keep people out of there, and they weren't very successful there.
I guess I refer to the townships. I guess that applies to the cities also, I guess,
right.
Are there any big projects going on in the cities and townships? I mean, not that we control them.
Right.
I just like to know what's going on, I guess. So.
I suppose maybe that's when we hear at the small city meetings, we hear their short-term plans, maybe not always their long-term plans, but like the city of Holly is pretty proactive. They've got its engineering, city of Dilworth as well.
Yeah.
City of Sabin, we've worked with them all. We don't actually get probably capital improvement plans like we do, but I know they keep us in the loop on things that they're working on.
I want to re-clarify what I was talking about. Each township has to levy a certain dollar amount to their road and bridge fund,
right,
in order to qualify for the state assistance for townships. That's what I was referring to. So
I think that large part of their budget is gravel, and then if they've got a bridge replacement,
right,
or something, that they have a small share to.
Okay, any further questions? Not, we need to close the meeting, I guess.
I move to close the hearing.
Second.
Got a motion by Kevin, second by Grant, to close the public hearing on 5-year road construction plan. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. All right. Back to the regular meeting. I guess we need to approve this plan, or are there any questions or changes to it?
I'd move that we adopt the 5-year proposed construction program.
Second the motion.
Okay, we've got a motion by Kevin, second by Jenny, to approve the 5-year plan. Any further discussion?
I just want to thank you. There's been a lot of road issues that have been brought to my attention over the past few years, and I appreciate your willingness to look at those, and I see some of those have been added, and I think it does reflect concerns as we see them, and so I encourage the public to continue to reach out to us if they have concerns on road issues, and we can address them that way.
Okay, we've got a motion on the floor. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I don't know if we got time to go through committee reports, or should we hold off till next week?
Yeah, we got about 4 minutes, so.
That won't give us time to go, even Kevin to make his, you know.
No. Well.
No.
I was going to make mine short and sweet, but now I'm not going to.
No, you always give good reports.
I can do mine fast.
Okay, if you want to do yours, go ahead.
Perfect. Last week, I attended the SWCD meeting that was held on Tuesday instead of Thursday. Good work continues there. They did purchase a mower to help mow some. They're going to be mowing our county-owned property, the pollinator habitat, so helping out the highway department that way. Commissioner Gross and I attended the Extension Committee meeting. They've definitely adapted to the challenge of COVID, so they're doing a lot of virtual opportunity learning that way. And then Friday, I attended the District 4 AMC meeting. Really good input from all of the counties, and good to hear their reports. That concludes my report.
Go for it, Kevin.
All right. Tuesday the 9th, we had a highway tracking meeting. Most of the things we've discussed. We did get an update on Casaw 1, 5-year construction plan, some drainage studies regarding County Road 18 that we're working together with the Watershed District on. And then that same day, I also met with Kirk and Steve Moore regarding some delivery issues with the Perham regional facility, the deliveries that we have there. And Friday morning, I did get on to the AMC district meeting, but I couldn't stay on very long. And each and every one of those days, I attended almost full days with the trial. I've been involved with the trial, and again, that was yesterday, and today the trial went on all day again, and it looks like it might wrap up tomorrow, if not tomorrow, Thursday. That's all I have.
Grant?
Okay, let's see. I had the AMC Public Safety Committee meeting last week, and we discussed the legislative issues involving changes for law enforcement. We had a PIC meeting and discussed the governor's plans for opening things back up. Had a radio board meeting and mainly discussion about grants that would be available. Listened in on the District 4 meeting last Friday. Had a Dancing Sky meeting yesterday and talked about funding issues in our budget for next year. And I listened in or attended a Greater Minnesota Parks and Trails meeting today. And that was it for me.
Okay, I had Tuesday the PIC committee also that we talked about already, where we're talking about phase 3, bringing employees back. Tuesday also with highway tracking. That's already been discussed in most of the things we covered today. Wednesday, extension committee, which Jenny has covered. After that, I attended virtually through for the Wild Rice Watershed Board and listened to their meeting. Okay, and then Friday was the District 4 meeting, and I took notes in every county that reported, and I was taking notes in each county that reported it, and it looks like their sales tax revenues are all coming in ahead of what they expected. The property tax is coming in. Their collections are coming in ahead of it. You know, so of course they're all looking at budget, trying to stay at zero, you know, and stuff like that. But I mean, it looked like most of the counties are in good shape the way they reported, and that was good to hear. Okay. Steve, you got anything?
The only thing I would just add is that you'll be receiving an email with a proposed schedule for reappointments or appointments. We have three positions within the Buffalo Red, two full-time, two three-year contracts for managers and one-year position. And so for our citizens, the week of June 22nd, June 29th, will be published notice for interest in the Holly Herald and the Fargo Forum Legals. And we'll be accepting applications through July 14th, with interviews at this board meeting July 21st. I have it set up that there's three interviews that we would not make a decision on the 21st, but would look to make a decision at the board meeting on the 28th.
I think you meant to say interviews for the three appointments, not three interviews.
Sorry, yes, three appointments.
Would you, Kathy Fanger from the Watershed had reached out to me asking about that schedule. Could you reach out to her and let
sure.
them
know?
Sure. Mr. Chair, I wonder if it wouldn't be in our best interest to go beyond just those two publications and do it in every publication that we have in Clay County.
Okay.
I just think that advertisement, I think it should go on everyone.
All right, we will put those out in all publications, and I think that concludes my report.
Okay, anybody else? Or adjourn.